why it does not exist. So we're looking at, I guess we'll do this I, the limit as x approaches 2 from the right. So you got to find 2 and then from the right. So you're going to the right and you're looking for the y value. So it's that point right there. Now it doesn't have to actually exist. It just wants the y value there. So it looks like it's 3. Is that familiar to you?
Yes.
Okay. Now, number 2 here is the limit as x approaches -3 from the right. So the whether it's positive or negative comes out in front, okay? Positive means from the right. So where's -3? Here's -3. From the right, it's this one down here, and it's the y value. That's 0.
It doesn't have to be defined.
It only for so this is a one-sided limit.
Okay, yeah, all right.
All right, so now -3 here, so just -3, that one does not exist because the one from the left here and from the right are different.
What do you mean?
So do you see how the value from the left here at -3, this is -3 here on the graph?
Mm-hmm.
From the left, it's approaching -2. From the right, it's approaching 0.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah, I mean, like usually what the kind of thing I would expect you to get is like they pick a number and it's like from the left, from the right, from the left, and then there, but
right.
You know, we'll see. So x approaches 4. Okay. So here's 4. Okay. Now there's a hole there, but do you see that it approaches the same value from the left and from the right?
Right. Yep.
So that exists, even though there's nothing there, it approaches the same thing. So that looks like it's 2 because that goes up by 1. So that dot there is 2.
Mm-hmm.
Is that okay?
Yep.
All right. Now, limit as x approaches 0. Okay. So whenever, if there's not a plus or a minus, that means you got to look from both sides. So from the left, it's going up to positive infinity. From the right, it's also going up to positive infinity. So those both approach the same value, positive infinity. Right? Is that okay?
Yep.
All right. Now this one on the next one here is 6. 2 from the left. That negative means from the left. So you're gonna go find 2. Okay, here's 2. Vertically, here's 2. And then from the left is going this way. And see how that goes down forever. That goes down to minus infinity. So the point of a one-sided limit, which is that's a one-sided limit, double I is a one-sided limit, I is a one-sided limit, they always exist. One-sided limits always exist because they always approach something from one side or the other. They're always going to mm-hmm. approach some value. Okay, V double I, limit as x approaches infinity. So that's as you're going out to the right here. So what is this approaching? It's approaching this value here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Looks like it's approaching 4 there. Negative infinity is going the other way. Now see how it's going the other way here? What's the horizontal asymptote that it's approaching there?
-1.
-1. Great. Okay, so B, kind of just answer B. There's 2 horizontal asymptotes. One is at y equals 4. That's this one up over here.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other one is y equals -1. That's the values you just told me there.
And then the vertical asymptotes are 0?
Yeah. So the vertical asymptotes, there's one here at 0 for sure.
Isn't that 2?
Yeah. See, I think there's one there, although it's kind of unclear. Yeah. It's only from one side. Right. But I think there's still one there. So 0 on x equals 2, although it's defined there. That's what makes it kind of challenging. I'm not sure. I wouldn't have made this graph because it creates that point of confusion. So now discontinuous, we can talk about, and that is important. So there's a couple of types of discontinuities you're looking for. One are holes, at vertical asymptotes, jumps.
Right.
Okay, so like there's one there, we'll do, and it is out of order, D. There's one there at negative three. At negative three there, there's that jump. At zero, there's this vertical asymptote. And then at two, there's this like vertical asymptote to a value, okay? And then here at four, there's this hole. Mm-hmm. So you get a little variety there.
Alrighty. No. Let's do the ones below it, the 21 through the 36 section.
Okay. Yeah. You know, you might get one of these. You know, this grouping, you know, I don't know which one. So let's do 21. The first thing you try, the first thing you always try, and the first thing you kind of circle back to is you always just try the value. You're like, okay, well, like, does this work? What's the cosine of zero plus sine zero? This is unit circle stuff again. So sine of zero is right there. It's the y value. The y value there is zero. Zero plus zero, zero. So what is the cosine of zero? That's the x value there.
Yeah, one.
One, okay. So again, you just try it. Does not work for the next one. So one of the techniques that you learned is to do some sort of manipulation. So here you need to factor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now I like to factor it above and below. So this is difference of squares above. And this is just type A equals one below. And you cancel anything that like is in the top and the bottom. So that cancels and that cancels. Okay. And actually, I guess we could have put three in this one. We didn't have to factor. It just makes it a little easier for us. So like when you put three in, you get three minus three over three minus one. Zero on top is okay. But zero on the bottom is not.
Right.
All right. So do you want to try the next one on your own? Maybe 23. It's actually really similar. You get down. You actually get down.
It looks the exact same, but
it's a slightly different value. So this one,
negative six over negative four, right?
Right, exactly. So it's like this one. So it becomes negative six over negative four, which is 3/2. And 24 is different. It's very different because it's a different, it's like it's an asymptote this time. So
when it gives one-sided limits like this, it tells you to find that's what I get kind of confused when I see that.
So, I'm sorry, say that one more time.
Like when I see a one-sided limit, like as x approaches one from the right, and these like find the limit.
Yeah, I mean this one is weird because it's an asymptote. So it goes down to the limit as x approaches three, x minus three over x minus one. And what you got to know is like, well, what does the graph do at one? Like is it this and this, or is it the other way?
Uh-huh.
You know, and that's what's hard. So what you do is you try a number a little bit bigger than one. So like 1.0001. Okay. And you're looking to see like what happens to this. Does it get like really large or really small? So like 1.0001 minus three over 1.001 minus one on the bottom it's really, really small. And up top, it's a negative.
Mm-hmm.
So a negative over a really, really small number becomes a gigantic negative number.
Okay. Right. Now, what if it, where am I?
So let's do the other way. Let's say it wanted the limit as x approaches one from the other direction. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's a little bit less than one. So that's like 0.999. So that if we go back over here, 0.999 minus three over 0.999 minus one. So on the bottom, it's negative 0.0001, which is really small. And up top, it's a negative number. So this time that the two negatives cancel and you get positive infinity because it's a number over a really, really small number.
Okay.
Okay. So that takes care of that page. Where would you like to go next with this review?
One where it's basically a continuation of what we're just doing. The 25, 27, it's in the top right, all those limits.
Okay. Yeah. We'll look at 25. So 25 requires you to know the sum or difference of cubes. Okay. So there's a few formulas you gotta remember here. So sometimes you just like try stuff. Okay, like in this case, you got to expand that h minus one cubed, and that is a formula. So it's h, and I should do it above it. It's h cubed. Sorry, I am not doing this right. it is h minus one times h minus one times h minus one plus one. I was looking at something different. So if you FOIL, you get h squared minus 2h plus 1, but then you have to multiply it times h again. So you end up getting here h cubed, because you're multiplying everything by h, minus 2h squared, okay, plus h, okay, minus h squared. Now we're on this minus 1 times each of these three in here, mm-hmm. plus 2h minus 1, and then there's this plus 1 off to the side. So the numerator, you can see some cancellations here. You get h cubed minus 3h squared plus 3h all over h, limit as h goes to zero, okay? And you just divide each one. So you do your best here. You go, okay, this is really h squared minus 3h plus 3. And you always go back to that original thing we talked about, which is, just trying the number. So that's zero squared minus three times zero plus three. So it just becomes three. Mm-hmm. Can we do 29 instead of 27 or yep, is that okay? Because 29's got like, kind of a little wrinkle, I guess, in it. I don't know. These all do. These all sort of have like this little twist that if you don't know mm-hmm. how to do it, you're in problems. So if you try 16, you get 4 minus square root of 16, which is 4. So you get 0 up top. 16 minus 16 bottom, that's 0 on the bottom. Now, you may be able to use L'Hopital's rule, but I know you didn't know that in this part of the course.
Right.
Okay. So you got to be careful here that you don't use stuff that you weren't supposed to know. So there's this kind of like, well, what do I do here? Well, there's this non-obvious thing, which is to multiply the top and bottom by the conjugate. Okay. Now it's always the one with the root that you multiply by. So in the numerator, when you FOIL, okay, you get 16 16. 4 root s, 4 root s negative cancels, minus s. So you get the top becomes that, the bottom is s minus 16 times 4 plus square root of s. Now you're not supposed to FOIL the bottom. If you do, it'll be problematic. So do you see how 16 minus s and s minus 16, they're basically the same except for a negative?
Yeah.
So you can rewrite the top as negative s minus 16. And then you get, then they cancel. So this becomes, you got to write this s approaches 16, negative 1 over 4 plus square root of s. Okay. Now you can actually put the number in. So you just, it's negative 1 over 4 plus square root of 16. Square root of 16 is 4, it becomes negative 1/8.
Okay.
That last part is like the easy part. It's like you're already done. You already know everything there.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I actually don't know what to suggest on 27 without thinking a little bit more about this. There's some sort of like asymptote there. So does this say to do it algebraically on 27?
It just says find the limit. That's what it says.
Okay. There's something going on at 4. Or I'm sorry, at 9. You know, and I don't know what it is. I believe it's an asymptote here. So it's like one of those things where like that's why I asked, like it's almost like we gotta try a number a little bit smaller than 9,
mm-hmm.
and a number a little bit bigger than 9.
Well, we don't have to do it.
Well, okay. I mean, but that just you know, that is how you would attempt this.
Okay.
And they will both point to infinity when you're done.
Oh, okay. It doesn't even say to do it actually. So
okay. All right. Oh, where should we go next then?
Can we do? Let's do 28.
All right, 28. Okay, limit as v approaches 4 from the positive. Okay, so I I would do this sort of like the correct way to do this is to figure out what absolute value of 4 minus v is in terms of its piecewise function. Like, mm-hmm. And what I mean is like, you're going to find that it's 4 minus v in one case and it's v minus 4 in another.
Right.
Okay. But we can sort of circumvent that. So a little bit bigger than 4 is like 4.0001. So in the numerator, do you see that would produce a negative number? 4 minus 4.001 would be negative because the v is just a little bit bigger, so that's negative up top. On the bottom, it's always positive,
right? Because
okay, so it's a negative over positive, which means the end result is a negative.
Okay,
mm-hmm. So like what I'm trying to get you to see is that we replace this one on the bottom with the one on the right here that confirms what we just said. So it's actually this. Okay, this is the one that's good for v greater than 4. And let me try to show you why. So on the top here, this becomes negative v minus 4. You just factor out a negative in both, and then this becomes negative 1 because this cancels with this, and that's what we just set up here.
Mm-hmm.
If that wasn't clear, we could try another one like that. But these things within an absolute value of the same thing, they either approach negative 1 or 1. They're almost always graphs that are like this at that break point, which was 4 in this case.
Right.
These are very specific things. Like, I would just be careful that we're not like too specific a stuff that would be on a final, unless you have some guidance that that's going to happen.
I'm just going over all the test reviews that we had.
Okay.
I don't remember doing a problem like that on the first exam, to be honest. I could be wrong though.
But if you have your exams, it's always good to, you know, go through them again, look at them. You know, see what you see.
Yeah, I'd have to find them. I think they're right there though. Maybe. All right.
Which one? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
31.
Yeah, 31 is a good one. So infinite limits are treated slightly differently than any of the ones that we've done so far. So there's kind of the shortcut, and then there's the worked out way of doing it. So the worked out way of doing it is you look for the largest exponent in the top or the bottom. So in this case, it's x squared. Right. And you divide everything by that in this case. So here's the way that looks. Its limit is x goes to infinity, 1 plus 2x minus x squared all over x squared, big fraction bar. This one I just wrote corresponds to this one in the middle here, 1 minus x plus 2x squared all over x squared. This is like the correct way to do it. So in the numerator you get 1 over x squared plus 2 over x minus 1 over, in the denominator, 1 over x squared minus 1 over x plus 2. Okay. And then there's this thing here that says, this is kind of off to the side, the limit as x goes to plus or minus infinity, 1 over x to the p, where p is greater than 1, this is always 0. And so you use that because, like, this first one is like that. This is 0 here. This is 0 because instead of 1 over, you can think of it as just a number over, because the number could come out in front. But this is 0, this is 0, and this is 0 for all that reason. So it becomes just this minus 1 over 2. So the answer here is it just becomes this minus 1 over 2. Because all these other go to 0. Let me make a note of that here also. I'm doing it in blue. Like, that goes to 0, that goes to 0, that goes to 0, and that goes to 0. So you're just left with this.
Oh, he also did say.
But you can also just shortcut it to be the ratio of the leading terms here. But, right. Like.
Yeah. Oh, okay, all right. He also did, I'm just now remembering this. He said he's going to pick out problems that are like easier ones of all the sections. Because we have to study so much material anyway.
Yes. That was kind of my point. It's like, you got to be careful. You're not getting so far in the weeds. You're like,
we probably are, to be honest.
Yeah. but you know, I mean, don't not attempt a problem because of that, but you know, think about that, you know, as you're going through your own stuff here.
Right. What problem was that? Did we just do 31?
31, yeah.
Okay, let me see. Can we do number 45 on that same page?
Yep. We got to look forward here. Okay. Yeah. Do you think you'll have any curve sketching or just plotting?
Probably. Yeah. There'll probably be some curve sketching.
Okay. All right. Well, so A is going back into this piecewise function here at the top. So X less than 0. You can think of that as like 0 from the left almost. Mm-hmm. And this one is like 0 from the right. This is 3 from the left. And then this is 3 from the right. Maybe that would help here. So because like you need to know which one to put the number in to get the value. Mm-hmm. And if you don't realize that x less than 0 means from the left, because left less than zero is left of zero, you don't know which one to do. So limit as x approaches zero from the right means to use this one, even though it may or may not be defined there. It's still like, what is it approach? What is it approach? You know? So in this case, like letter I is 3 minus 0, which is 3. Double I, 0 from the left, it's the square root of -0, which is weird, but it's the square root of 0, which is 0, because you got to use that one. Triple I, limit as x approaches 0, f of x. Problem is like these two don't match. So this does not exist because 3 does not equal 0. That's from, you know, I and then from double I. Is that clear so far?
Yep.
All right, IV. So for limit as x approaches 3 from the left, so that's 3 minus 3. You gotta use that middle one, which is 0. And then V, it's 3 from the right. So that's 3 minus 3 squared, which is 0. Because they approach the same value, this one equals 3 because they match, you know, that these two numbers match here.
Right.
Sorry, it equals 0, not 3. 0. Okay, so where is f discontinuous? It is discontinuous at the place where the values don't match. So see how at I and double I there's a break, 3 and 0. If they were the same, it would be continuous. But at the other one, they do match. They do make the same value, 0 and 0.
So you would just say?
Just at x equals 0.
Oh, okay. All righty.
Okay, so the proper way to graph this is to do it in chunks. So the first one you're looking at when x is less than 0. So if you're making a graph here, I don't know how accurate your instructor needs you to be, but it's the square root of negative x. So you need to know, like, well, what does the square root of x look like? The square root of x goes out to the right here, starting at 0. This negative inside flips it over that. So, but there's a hole there because it's not defined at 0.
Right.
And it goes kind of like that.
Okay.
And then this 3 minus x, it's just a line. It starts at the b value of 3. And the slope is -1. So it goes down 1, down 1, down 1. But at 3, it's not defined there. So that's an open circle. Okay. And that's that discontinuity we just talked about. But now, if x is greater than 3, it's 3 minus 3, which is squared. Oh, actually, I misspoke here. Even though these limits are the same, it's not defined at 3. So it's also discontinuous at 3. Because even though it approaches the same value, there's no line underneath, no line underneath. So there's nothing happening at 3. It's a small point, but it's important, I guess. So this last graph of x minus 3 squared, 3 comma 0 is the vertex of it. So if you put 3 in, you get 0 here. But it's not defined. And so the way that these work is you get some points like this, and it goes up like that. I think the type of curve sketching you're likely to see is like f prime is positive in this region, or it's concave down in this region, or has a min or a max in that region.
All right, let's do number 47. I feel like that'll definitely be on the exam.
Okay.
It's at the very, 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 very bottom.
Okay. Intermediate value theorem.
Yeah.
Okay. So the intermediate value theorem, way it's used is for a root is that you check one endpoint and then you check the other endpoint, but what you're looking for is the following scenario. It's either plus to minus or minus to plus. Because if it's plus to minus, that means it's above the x-axis, then the minus means it's below. We're not talking about the derivative, we're talking about the literal value here. Okay, so it's basically like if it went from, you know, whatever number to whatever number, it had to go through zero. That's what it means by root. So we're gonna find f of one, which is 1 to the 5th minus 1 cubed plus 3 times 1 minus 5. So that's 1 minus 1, that cancels. 3 minus 5 is -2. Mm-hmm. And then f of 2 to the 5th minus 2 cubed plus 3 times 2 minus 5. So that's 32 minus 8, 24 plus 6 is 30, minus 5 is 25. So see, yeah, this one is negative, this one is positive.
Yep.
It's the only way this can happen, since it's continuous, is there must be a root between those two values. And that's all you have to show. Plus maybe some words that say like, yeah, like since one is negative, one is positive, you do that.
Okay. All righty. Let's do the 3 through 6 section where it says find the tangent line
to
the curve.
All right. We'll start with 3. I'm gonna just modify this slightly without actually changing the problem. Like, let's just say they said when x equals 2. Okay, and you're supposed to find the tangent line. So the tangent line requires two things. It requires a point and it requires a slope. Sometimes they give you the point like they do here, but if you don't have the point, you need the x value. You put the x value back in, okay, to get the y value. So if you're not given the point, you have to find the point, but you have the point, 2, -4. So you're 1 of 2 ready to go. The slope always comes from the derivative. So you need y prime, 4 minus 6x. You evaluate y prime at the x value. So you evaluate y prime at 2, 4 minus 6 times 2, that's -8. That's your slope. Mm-hmm. So now the only equation you ever want to use is y minus y1 equals slope x minus x1. And you have a slope, -8, and you have a point, 2, -4. So you substitute those values back in. Sorry, my thing isn't cooperating. So it's y minus a minus 4 equals -8 x minus 2. Is that clear?
Yep.
Okay. Why don't you try number 4 on your own? All you got to do there is find the slope, substitute the x value in. Take a minute here. I need a short reset here myself, so just give me a moment here too to do that. All right, so y prime is 3x squared minus 3. You evaluate it at 2. 3 times 2 squared minus 3 gives you 9. So it's y minus 3 equals 9 times x minus 2. And you just leave it like that. You don't want to manipulate it any further. So I'd suggest doing 5 and 6 on your own, because they're good derivative practice.
Do you, and, for these, do you just do the x value? Do you just look at it?
Yes.
Okay.
Now there, you did do tangent lines with implicit derivatives, but I'm not seeing any of those here. I mean, you're right. You went way back in the course. So this is.
Yeah. I'll probably have an appointment scheduled for every day this week up until Thursday.
Sure. Is there something else we can move to? Because this, you surely know how to take derivatives by now. And maybe just take a minute or two and just send over something new you'd like to work on. Get the most out of your time today.
Or can we just do two problems of these ones, 19 through 27 ones? Please do one or two.
That's okay, let's do 25.
Okay.
For sure, because we haven't done a quotient rule yet. But again, you totally know how to do this. This one we will simplify.
I'm more state the domain of the function and the domain of its derivative.
All right.
The domains flip when you take the derivative, right?
Well, the domain of this, you say, okay, domain anything, but where the bottom is zero. So the bottom is zero at t equals -3.
Uh-huh.
So it's -infinity to -3, union -3 to infinity.
Okay. And then you just take the derivative.
Yes. So the derivative will change that, but the bottom actually, it just becomes 3 plus t squared. So it actually doesn't affect.
Right.
But in terms of derivatives, you know, it's bottom.
Yeah.
Times the derivative of the top. The derivative of the top is just -2 minus the top times the derivative of the bottom, which is just 1. So these actually tend to simplify nicely because the top is just like coefficients. This is -2 times 3 is -6 -2t, and then you negate these, so it's -1 plus 2t. And then you combine like terms. So the two t's actually cancel. This becomes -7 plus over 3 plus t squared.
Okay. So, and then the domain's not affected at all?
No, not by this one.
Okay. All right.
We can look though at like a 26, because that does, I mean, it's a simplistic one, but it does, its domain is impacted.
Yeah.
Because of that.
Yeah.
Okay. These problems look very intimidating when you first saw them, but now they're not so much. Right. So this is the square root. Sometimes it's good to write this. It's the square root of x cubed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that 2 goes to the bottom. So the thing with square roots though is you can only take the square root of a positive number. Okay, even though like you know now because you've taken enough math, you know the square root of -1 is I. That's not what this is asking. That's not right here. So right now, x has to be greater than or equal to 0. That's your domain, bracket 0 to infinity. But then we have to take a derivative. So your derivative, actually, this one doesn't change. Let me change this to 1/2, if that's okay. Mm-hmm. Nothing changes it, but it will change the derivative. So the derivative is 1/2 x to the -1/2. Okay. And you might be thinking, well, how does that change anything? Well, let me just rewrite this. It's 1 over 2 square root of x. You're also not allowed to divide by 0. So see how this was bracket? Well, yeah. Now it can't be 0. So the domain goes to 0 to infinity. Because you can't divide by 0.
Mm-hmm. All right. I'll just grab a problem real quick from a different chapter.
Sounds good.
This one's just implicit differentiation. I gotta remember how to do this. Let's just do one of those because I just gotta be reminded how to do it.
All right. Did you send me something new here?
Not yet. I'm looking at page 141. Can I just tell you the problem?
Yeah, as long as I can write it out correctly, yeah, that would be good. Go ahead.
All right. It is. Okay, I just lost it. Okay, here we go. X, y to the fourth plus x squared y equals x plus 3y.
Okay, this is a great one to do. All right, so this is implicit derivative, okay? And I'm sure that's why you're asking me to take a look at this. The first one is product rule, okay? Mm-hmm. So product rule is first times the derivative of y to the fourth. Now you treat y to the fourth like it's an x when you take the derivative. So that's 4y cubed, that's power rule, okay?
But you add a y prime to it.
You gotta add a y prime to it, okay? Mm-hmm. And this is where you got to be careful that you don't lose track. Like, you're not moving on to this one. It's product rules. So you got to go back here. So now it's derivative of the first, or if you want to keep the second, but it becomes y to the fourth times one. Okay. So all of this goes with this. And, you know, I don't know how you want to do this, but like this next one's going to create two terms as well. So you just want to make sure you don't miss anything.
Mm-hmm.
So the derivative x squared y, okay, keep the first. Derivative of y, if it was x, would be 1, but because it's y, it's a y prime.
Mm-hmm.
Plus y, derivative of x squared is 2x equals. Okay, and I think the challenge here is just the back and forth of the rules,
right?
You know, like product rule, implicit, you know, it's all that stuff. Derivative of x is 1. Derivative of 3y, well, you treat y like it's an x, so that would be 3, but then there's a y prime there. So the next step here is to group the y prime terms together on one side.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to move them all left and everything else right. So this is going to be my first one here. It's going to be 4xy cubed y prime. You could even just put the equal sign here in the middle. This y to the fourth is going to go over here to the other side. But it's going to be 1 minus y to the fourth. So I took care of that one. This next one has a y prime in it. So I'll leave it there. I'm going to move this 2xy over. And I'm going to move this 3y prime over to the left.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now you can take more than one line to do that, but that is what you're doing. Now you're going to factor out the y prime.
Mm-hmm.
So it's y prime 4xy cubed plus x squared minus 3 equals 1 minus y to the fourth minus 2xy. And then the last step here is to divide.
Divide all of that.
Yeah, so your y prime equals all this stuff. I had a physics professor say ATC, and he said all that crap. And it was because we're just so much to write here.
Yeah. I actually enjoyed doing those when we were learning them.
Yeah. So you should be able to do this on your own. It's not difficult. The hardest part, again, is just not.
I just got to re-remember it.
Yeah. And like my concern would be like you do part of the product rule and then you move on to the next one. Right. So product rule always produces two terms.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do product rule twice, there should be four terms, and there are. That could be your built-in in check here on this one.
All right, I got one more.
Sure.
And then we can wrap it up. It is sine of xy equals x squared minus y.
Is this correct as it is written?
Yep.
All right, so on the left here, there is a product rule, but it's not first. The first is the derivative of the function, the outside.
Mm-hmm.
So you start with the outside function, then it's chain rule. Chain rule leads you to product rule.
Right.
So you start with sine. Derivative of sine is cosine. You keep the inside function. You keep it.
Right.
But now you multiply by the product rule of x, y. Okay, so x derivative of y is 1, y prime, plus, keep the second, derivative of x is 1, equals, derivative of x squared is 2x, minus derivative of y, you treat it like it's an x, so that's 1, but then you always have to have a y prime.
Mm-hmm.
So the before you group the y primes, sometimes you have to distribute, do a little bit of things here to make this cleaner. So this is x cosine xy y prime. Now it's my preference to put the y primes to the right of it. It's just the way I've always done it. I like to have the x out in front, but that's what I'm multiplying in. Plus y cosine xy. Okay, and now we're ready to group those y prime terms. So I'm gonna move it over, move this one over. X cosine xy y prime plus y prime equals 2x minus y cosine xy.
Then just factor everything out.
Yes. Divide. So you factor out your y prime and then you divide. And you get 2x minus y cosine xy over x cosine xy plus 1. So when you factor out the y prime on this side, I guess I should show that here. It's plus 1 here.
Right, okay. All righty. That's all I got for today.
Great. Well, thanks so much for scheduling. I'm getting pretty full. So if you don't see a time, just text me. I'll try to figure something out with you.
Okay.
If you're available early in the day, it would help too.
Yeah, I don't have classes all this week. So
okay. So just text me and I'll throw up a time and you can do it the way you've always done. But yeah, thanks so much and see you next time. Okay, right. I know.